JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for July the 30th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar continued trading lower against the majority of the other G10 currencies on Wednesday during the Asian morning Thursday. It underperformed the most versus NOK, CHF, SEK and GBP in that order, while it eked out some gains only versus the New Zealand dollar. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Japanese yen. Now, the weakness in the dollar and the yen suggests that markets traded in a risk-on fashion yesterday. However, the weakening of the kiwi, as well as the fact that the franc was among the main gainers, point otherwise. Thus, in order to get a better picture on the broader investor morale, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, most major EU indices closed in negative waters ahead of the FOMC decision, but the US ones ended positive in the aftermath of the announcement, gaining on average 1.07%. The improved appetite rolled over somewhat during the Asian morning today as well, although Japan's Nikkei slid 0.28%. At the time of the recording, China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng are up 0.15% and 0.78% respectively. Yesterday, the main event on the agenda was the FOMC decision. As was widely anticipated, the committee kept interest rates unchanged and repeated that they will continue to increase purchases of bonds and mortgage-backed securities, at least at the current pace, which suggests that purchases can accelerate if deemed necessary. On top of that, officials added that the path of the economy will depend significantly on the course of the coronavirus, and although activity and employment have picked up somewhat in recent months, they remain well below their levels at the beginning of the year. At the press conference following the decision, Fed Chair Jerome Powell said that they are committed to do what they can and for as long as it takes. The current stance is appropriate and we are prepared to adjust as appropriate, he added. He also repeated that he also repeated and even enhanced his previous statement that they are not even thinking about raising interest rates, adding a thinking about to highlight that interest rates are likely to stay at the current level until officials are certain that the economy has weathered the pandemic and is on track for maximum employment and price stability goals. Now, in our view, the key takeaway from this meeting is that policymakers are willing to expand their stimulative efforts if the situation worsens. That said, when asked about what more could be done, Powell said that more fiscal support would help. Equities rebounded on the Dovish message from the Fed, but now it seems that the ball is on the Congress's court. Yesterday, US President Donald Trump said that his administration and Democrats in Congress are still far apart on a new coronavirus aid bill. With the enhanced unemployment benefits expiring tomorrow, investors are biting their nails in anticipation over whether a common ground will be found. The Republicans proposed a $1 trillion US plan, but the Democrats see that proposal as not sufficient and instead suggest a $3 trillion US bill. As we noted yesterday, for equities to stay supported, we believe that any agreed plan has to be as close as possible to Democrats' proposal. Anything near the $1 trillion or even lower may come as a disappointment. Republicans' plans is not considered insufficient only by Democrats, but also by many market participants. Now, apart from headlines and developments surrounding the debate in Congress over the new coronavirus bill, investors may also keep an eye on the first estimate of the US GDP for the second quarter. The forecast suggests that the coronavirus-related lockdown caused the economy to collapse by a historic 34% quarter-over-quarter seasonally adjusted annual rate, after contracting 5% in the first 3 months of the year. The Atlanta Fed GDP Now model points to a minus 32.1% rate, close to the consensus, but the New York Nowcast suggests that the economy contracted only 14.3%. If indeed the actual print is closer to the New York estimate, risk-linked assets are likely to gain and safe havens could slide, as this will mean that the economic wounds from the coronavirus are not as severe as initially afraid. As on the other hand, a worse than expected number would raise fears and concerns that the already adopted stimulative measures are not having the desired effect and that more may be needed. This may strengthen the view that $1 trillion US dollars aid package by the US government may not be enough. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning, we have Germany's first estimate of GDP for the second quarter and the nation's preliminary CPIs for July. The German GDP is forecast to have contracted 9% quarter over quarter after shrinking 2.2% in the first quarter, while the CPI rate is anticipated to have fallen to 0.1% year over year from 0.9%. The German unemployment rate, as well as that for the bloc as a whole, for the Eurozone as a whole, are also coming out. The German rate is expected to have ticked up to 6.5% from 6.4%, while the Euro area one is forecast to have risen to 7.7% from 7.4%. As for tonight, during the Asian morning Friday, we have Japan's employment and industrial production data for June. The unemployment rate is expected to have increased to 3.1% from 2.9%, while the jobs to applications ratio is anticipated to have declined to 1.16 from 1.20. Industrial production is anticipated to have rebounded 1.2% month over month after falling 8.9%. Now in China, the official PMIs for July are coming out. The manufacturing index is anticipated to have ticked up to 51 from 50.9, but no forecast is available for the non-manufacturing and composite prints. Following the second outbreak of the coronavirus in China, it would be interesting to see whether there were any economic damages due to that, and if so, how severe they were. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.